Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom.
Is this working? Yeah. Peggy has an announcement about upcoming events here at Stony Point.
The International Association of Women Ministers is holding an assembly here Monday to Thursday, July 20 to 23. And we're going to have Margaret Amer speaking to us about contextual Bible study and making the connections between the Bible and contemporary issues. And also Ophelia Ortega from Matanzas Seminary in Cuba is going to be here with us and keeping us up to date on some of the things going on in Cuba. So I have more information about it if anybody's interested. And I have brochures.
Thanks, Peggy. Someone last night asked me about the peace discernment process and wondered if we were going to do anything with that. Let me see a show of hands of those that have never heard about the Presbyterian peace discernment process. Okay, so you're pretty much aware. We're now 5 years into a six-year peace discernment process in Presbyterian Church USA. And right now, there are five affirmations, just sort of one long convoluted sentence statements, that we're asking presbyteries to study together and to vote on and to send their feedback to Louisville through the Office of General Assembly. If you are involved in a presbytery where you live, and your presbytery has not looked at that yet, we really hope that they will sometime this summer or even into September, in the September meeting. It's really important to the process that we get as much feedback as we can from the wider church, from presbyteries across the country. And with that, if there are no other announcements,
I have one question. I had thought the deadline was July 31st or something.
That's the official deadline. I don't have on my calendar the next meeting of the Peace and Sermon steering team to look at the feedback and see about tweaking the document or rewriting or whatever. I imagine that won't happen until October. I don't see that it's going to happen in August. So if things dribble in after that July deadline, I don't think we're going to ignore them. We want to look at whatever input comes in. Yeah,
I just to piggyback on what Ann is saying, yes, we, as Roger mentioned, officially deadline is the 31st, but encourage presbyteries, if you're talking to them, and I know some of us have been talking to presbyteries, if you're talking to them, continue to encourage them in the process. I'm Paul Horton and I, Chris, I also have been calling presbyteries and reminding EPs and folks that are in charge of running things that they should be well on this process. And if you know anyone that says, well, look, we need some guidance, can someone help, we would be willing to do Skype, conference call, anything needed to talk more about these affirmations and to really encourage our presbyteries to be engaged in conversations about peace.
Thanks. And Rick, you said this is being live streamed?
Yes, so watch what you say. We had a few requests last night that we might try and live stream it, and I think we've got the technology working. So you can go home and watch it again. It'll be on the Stony Point Center YouTube channel. All you can do is go on YouTube and Google Stony Point Center and you'll get it.
And now we have the privilege of hearing from Paul Chappell once again.
Thank you. I have a few friends from out of town I'd like to introduce. So this reminds me of how important teamwork is with piecework. I can't do this work without the help of other people, and then being here reminds me just how dependent I am on other people to make this work, because waging peace is really a team sport. And I'm very grateful for people who have helped me and made all this work possible. So Jody Bionic, she's from Washington, D.C., and she's come out today. And Susie Joyner, she comes from Lynchburg, Virginia. And Joanne Dex, she came from Randburg, Connecticut. Mary McCarthy, she came from Springfield, Massachusetts. So it's very important that we keep in mind our interconnectedness, how much we have to rely on others for peace work to be effective. You learn this in the military. The military relies upon cooperation. A military unit can't function without cooperation. You're part of a team, and I think peace work is very similar to that. And this book, The Art of Waging Peace, I dedicated to Joanne Deck. I wrote, "For Joanne Deck, goddess of compassion and strategic mastermind." Goddess of compassion in the flesh. Trust me, she's earned that title 100 times over. So I want to begin with a couple of things. Yesterday during the group discussion, I wanted all of you to discuss forms of dehumanization that I had not addressed in my talk. And I'm wondering if any of you talked about the forms of dehumanization that activists do against other groups. Any, did your group talk about that?
Yeah.
So what did you talk about, what in particular?
We just talked about the fact that, at the very least, we tend to assume that people who have very different views from ours are idiots. When in fact they may have very rational and carefully thought out reasons, even if we massively disagree with them, by feeling the way they do.
So I mean, that's a great point. Thank you for sharing that. And it's something I want to talk about briefly. I met several activists in activist groups, and they refer to people in the Tea Party as teetards, which is a term derived from the very offensive and derogatory term retard, right? And I apologize for using that word, but when someone uses the word teetard, that's what they're basically saying about people in the Tea Party. And I met a very prominent activist. He was living in Berkeley. I won't mention his name. But he and I were talking to a group of people who were there as well, and he said, "You know what? I wish we could get rid of everybody from the South." He said, "I wish we would have let the South win the Civil War so they would just leave the country." And I said, "Look, I'm from Alabama, and I've been from the South is in that stereotype." Or what about the term gun nuts? These people are gun nuts, right? So we have to be very careful, because we stand against dehumanization, right? Sarah Palin, for example, she doesn't take on dehumanization as something she advocates against. She doesn't claim she's open-minded. So if she's not open-minded, she's not being hypocritical. She never claims to be open-minded. But if we're not open-minded, we claim to be open-minded. So if we do it, then there's some hypocrisy involved. If we dehumanize, we're supposed to be the advocates against dehumanization. Right? So we have to be very careful about our own language. And we have to keep in mind why it's so important that we don't do this. So when I was in the Army, there was a colonel who told me, in order to think strategically, you have to be able to see the world from the other person's point of view. If you can't see the world from the other person's point of view, you can't think strategically. Right? So in the art of war written over 2,000 years ago by Sun Tzu. Sun Tzu said, know your enemy. Know your enemy. Now, the deepest way to know another human being is through empathy. That is the deepest way to get to know you. I can see the world from your point of view. I can understand your emotions. Deep empathy is the deepest level where you can know another human being. So when Sun Tzu said, know your enemy, and Jesus said, love your enemy, when waging peace is concerned, it means the same thing, right? The deepest way to know another human being is through love. And when you love your enemy, or you know your enemy through love, you realize they're not really your enemy. Your real enemy is hatred. Your real enemy is ignorance. Your real enemy is misunderstanding. These things hold people's minds hostage. And that's why Martin Luther King Jr., he said that people are part of an evil system, but these people aren't evil. Many of these people are victims of this evil system. So I'm going to show how practically this applies. So Martin Luther King Jr. and Frederick Douglass both asked this question. Why are there so many poor people in the South? Have any of you ever wondered that? Why are there so many poor white people in the South? Poor white people. Mississippi, Arkansas, Alabama. Why are there so many poor white people in the South as compared to the North?
Lack of industrial opportunity.
Slavery kept wages down.
So both Frederick Douglass and Martin Luther King Jr. said, look, if you're a poor white person and rich white landowners have an entire class of people who work for free, black men work for free, black women work for free, how much are you going to pay a poor white person doing work? Not going to pay them hardly anything because you have an entire class of laborers who work without wages. And so Frederick Douglass and Martin Luther King Jr. both said that the reason why there is so much poverty in the South amongst white people is because of slavery. So slavery not only hurt the slave owner psychologically, it also hurt poor white people economically. And this is why you have people who join the KKK, a lot of people are poor. And Martin Luther King Jr. said, if you do not address the forgotten white poor, we are in big trouble. There's millions of poor white people that don't have opportunity, who are suffering. We have to help these people. We have to find common cause with them. So let me read you a quote. Martin Luther King Jr. said, many poor whites, however, were the derivative victims of slavery. As long as labor was cheapened by the involuntary servitude of the black man, the freedom of white labor, especially in the South, was little more than a myth. To this day, the white poor also suffer deprivation and the humiliation of poverty, if not of color. They are chained by the weight of discrimination, though its badge of degradation does not mark them. It corrupts their lives, frustrates their opportunities, and withers their education. It has confused so many poor whites by prejudice that they have supported their own rich white oppressors. It is a simple matter of justice that America, in dealing gratefully with the task of raising the Negro from backwardness, should also be rescuing a large stratum of the forgotten white poor. And here's Frederick Douglass writing in the 19th century. Frederick Douglass said, the slaveholders, with a craftiness peculiar to themselves, by encouraging the enmity of the poor laboring white man against the blacks, succeeded in making the said white man almost as much a slave as the black slave himself. Both white and black men were plundered, and by the same plunderers. The slave was robbed by his master of all his earnings, and the white laboring man was robbed by the slave system of the just results of his labor, because he was flung into competition with a class of laborers who worked without wages. The slaveholders blinded poor white men to this competition by keeping alive their prejudice against the slaves as men. The impression was cunningly made by slaveholders that slavery was the only power that could prevent the laboring white man from falling to the level of the slave's poverty and degradation. So the slaveholders got the poor white man to empathize with the slave owner, identify with the slave owner, rather than with the slaves. And Martin Luther King Jr. and Frederick Douglass said, poor white people and black people have a lot in common, and they should be working together. And how do we encourage that cooperation among them? So I want to talk about empathy. That'll be the theme, the power of empathy. That'll be the whole theme for this morning, and how we can apply empathy for waging peace, and why love is the most powerful force in the world. So to talk about this, I want to ask all of you a question. I often talk about how humans are naturally violent. That's one thing I talk about, write about a lot. And I support that claim by looking at military history. So to talk about the fact that humans aren't naturally violent. Now, we can become violent, but violence has causes, preventable causes, just like illnesses have preventable causes, right? So if somebody gets malaria or cancer or HIV or Ebola, I've never heard anyone say, that's human nature. You got malaria, that's human nature to get malaria. But if people become violent, people go, oh, that's human nature. Not realizing that violence has preventable causes, just like illnesses have preventable causes. There's a man, Gary Slutkin, he deals with gang violence. And he says that a long time ago, people used to see those who got plague or leprosy as evil people. And he says, violence is one of the great plagues of human history. He says, what causes violence can be as hidden as the microorganisms of the past. So here's a question. What is the greatest problem of every army in world history? Every army in world history, no matter what time period or culture, has a single greatest problem. Can you guess what that problem is? So I want you to imagine you're a Greek general. You're living in the 5th century BC, and you have a lot of problems, right? You're a Greek general, you're looking at your army. You have a lot of problems. Where do I get water? Do I have enough food? What is your biggest problem as a general?
People
want to
run
the army. Pardon? The other army. Now that's a great point. That's a huge problem. But what if I told you that this problem is actually bigger than the other army? Because if you don't solve this problem, the battle will never begin.
Getting
soldiers to kill. Getting them to fight. So armies have lots of problems. Logistics, supply, recruiting, food, water. The other army is a huge problem. This problem is necessary for the battle to begin. Without this problem being solved, the battle will never begin. The greatest problem of every army in world history is, when a battle begins, how do you stop soldiers from running away? If you look at combat, in combat, our flight response is far more powerful than our fight response. Most people's natural reaction, when you try to stab them or shoot them, most people's natural reaction is to run away as fast as they can, as far as they can. Ask anyone who's been in combat, and they will tell you it's terrifying. And General Patton said, anyone who says you're not afraid in combat is a lie. So I want you to forget about everything you've ever seen in a Hollywood movie, forget everything you've ever seen in a television show, and just think about your own common sense. If a grown man ran at you screaming with a machete, that'd probably freak you out, right? You probably want to run the other direction, right? So imagine 10,000 grown men with swords running at you trying to kill you. And you might have an army. What if their army outnumbers you 3-1? We see this today. What is by far the most common human reaction to a mass shooting when people are in the vicinity of a mass shooting? Panic. People are running around screaming. They're running out the door. They're jumping out windows. After the mass shooting, people are crying and they're traumatized and they have to go to therapy, many of them. And that's just one person with a gun. So we have this fear of being killed. Now, I first heard this idea at West Point. At West Point, every male cadet has to take boxing their freshman year as a mandatory class. Mandatory class boxing for all freshman men, optional for women. And my boxing instructor said that there are two reasons why you have to take boxing. First of all, you have to learn how to defend yourself. The second reason is because human beings are naturally afraid of fighting. We're naturally afraid of fighting, and you have to learn how to overcome that fear. So humans are naturally afraid of boxing. So what's scarier, boxing or tennis?
Boxing
or golf? Boxing, right? Boxing or basketball?
Boxing.
Now, if you think about boxing rationally, It's kind of strange that people are afraid of boxing. Think about what boxing really is. You're getting hit with a glove. So what? You're getting hit with a glove. Now, if you're doing amateur boxing, you have headgear on for added protection. There's a referee to protect both fighters. There's very strict rules in boxing. You can't punch, kick, or even the groin. So with all those safety precautions, it's kind of strange that people are so afraid of boxing, but people are still afraid of it. Now, compare boxing to fighting the Roman army. So in boxing, you cannot punch, kick, or knee to the groin. The Roman army would train their soldiers to stab people in the groin. So imagine you were facing 10,000 Roman soldiers, and they're going to do everything in their power to stab you in the groin and kill you. Right? Keep in mind, warfare, no referees. You kill people however you can kill people. You want to kill them in warfare, you stab them in the groin, stab them in the abdomen, you're trying to kill them, right? It's not like a sport. People often compare war to football. War is nothing like football. You can't grab someone's helmet in football, right? Think about how strict the rules are in football. Warfare, no rules on the battlefield. People kill however they can kill people. Now, if you look at ancient battles, you watch Braveheart or Gladiator, those movies don't depict how battles were fought. If you watch those movies, the two armies collide in the middle, they fight till everybody on one side is dead. Mel Gibson looks around, he's won the battle. That's not how battles were fought back then. The way battles would be fought is two armies would collide. Not many soldiers would die, because most of the fighting is happening at the front, and they're fighting in compact formation. Then one army will typically panic, and as they panic and run away, that's when they get massacred, when you retreat. That's when you inflict most of your casualties, usually through cavalry, running them down. Now, this is why if you look at ancient battles, you often see lopsided casualty numbers, where one army might lose 50% of their army, the other army might lose the majority of their army. Now, a friend of mine, she asked me, she said, how are these ancient armies able to get soldiers to fight? How are these ancient armies able to get soldiers to panic on the battlefield? The Spartans even panicked and ran away in three battles against the Greek city-state Thebes. And the Spartans surrendered in the battle to the Athenians in the Battle of Sphacteria. So a friend of mine, she asked me, how were the ancient armies able to get the other army to panic? And I said, they got them to panic and run away by trying to kill them. Right? When you try to stab people to death, it tends to make people panic. So I want to illustrate this with a story. Stories I think are effective. And this story, I think, refutes gender stereotypes. We have this gender stereotype that men are naturally warlike. But okay, if men are naturally warlike, why do the vast majority of men throughout history have to be drafted? And when the draft goes away, why do the vast majority of rich men not want to fight the military anymore? Right? So here's an excerpt. This is Julius Caesar writing about his own army. And this story, I think, shows the panic and the fear. This is Julius Caesar writing about his own army. Julius Caesar, he writes in the third person. And keep in mind, the Roman army was the most well-trained army in the world, arguably, at that time. So here they are in Gaul, going into Germany. The Gauls are, where modern-day France is. Caesar writing about Gaul and the Germans. The Roman soldiers began to question the Gauls and merchants there who talked about the enormous stature, incredible courage, and splendid military training of the Germans. Some affirmed that on many occasions when they had met them in battle, the very expression on their faces and the fierce glance of their eyes were more than they could endure. The gossip threw all Roman ranks into a sudden panic that completely unnerved them. Most of these Roman soldiers alleged some urgent reason or other for leaving camp and asked Caesar's permission to go. Some stayed out of shame and a desire to avoid the suspicion of cowardice, but they were unable to hide their feelings, and at times could not help shedding tears. Skulking in their tents, they bemoaned their fate or joined their friends in lamenting the peril that threatened them all alike. All over the camp, men were signing and sealing their wills. The talk of these frightened people gradually affected even seasoned campaigners, including some centurions and cavalry officers. Some even went so far as to tell Caesar that when he gave the command to strike camp in advance, the soldiers would be too panic-stricken to obey. So just the rumors of how big the Germans are, the Roman soldiers are crying, right? They're shedding tears, crying, panicking. Even the seasoned campaigners are breaking down out of terror and panic. But think about that, right? Why would they react like that? Think about getting a cavity today. Think about getting a cavity in the 5th century BC, or the 1st century BC, which is worse, right? Back then. Think about getting stabbed today. Think about getting stabbed in the 1st century BC, in the 5th century BC, which is worse. Right? You get stabbed today, you get rushed to the emergency room, they give you painkiller, they sew you back up. You get stabbed in the Roman army, you're in trouble, right? You're gonna die a painful, gruesome death. So, here's the very interesting thing about all of this. The very interesting thing about all of this is that people fought all the time back then. People were constantly fighting back then in the 5th century BC, even with little medical care. You had almost constant warfare in ancient Greece. You had the warring states period in China, around that same time. The Persian Empire is trying to conquer everybody. So now the question we have to ask is, if human beings have this fear of being stabbed to death, how are these ancient armies able to get soldiers to fight and not run away? So imagine you're a Greek general now, 5th century BC, you're looking at your army, and you know this about human nature. You know your soldiers do not want to die. They do not want to get stabbed to death. They do not want their wives to be widows and their children to be orphans. What do you tell your army to get them to fight? You're a Greek general looking at your army. What do you tell them to get them to fight?
Their wives and daughters are going to get raped.
So armies use many techniques. So one technique is a last resort might be to threaten your army, right? But let's say that Alexander the Great tells his army, if you don't fight, I'll kill you. When you look at bullies, bullies typically involve several larger people bullying a smaller person. Try bullying an army of 10,000 trained killers. Right? They might kill you. They might mutiny. You tell your army, if you don't fight, I'll kill you. These are grown men with weapons. You're going to threaten them, right? Now, money is another motivator. But people will fight for money, but people will rarely die for money. Because dying defeats the whole purpose of having money. So in the Iliad, Achilles says, no amount of wealth is worth my life. So people will fight for money, but if they're outnumbered, they say, well, if I die in this battle, maybe I should go the other direction, right? Think about a hitman. You hire a hitman to kill somebody. What if you tell the hitman, well, there's 90% chance you're going to die, right? Hitmen, they don't work like that. They prefer to kill people where there's little risk of them being killed themselves, right? So people will fight for money. People will even kill for money, but people will rarely die for money. But here's what people will die for. Here's a way to make this question clear. What would all of you die for? Raise your hand if you would risk your life to protect your family. Right? The battery?
Yeah,
I think so. So raise your hand if you risk your life to protect your family. That's what it's all about. Do you ever wonder why the army does this whole band of brothers thing? Why the army's a family unit? Do you think the army's sentimental?
Yeah.
The army does that out of military necessity. The Greeks realized that soldiers believe they are fighting to protect their friends, their family, and their loved ones. They will not only fight, but they will even sacrifice their lives. Because our instinct to protect our loved ones is more powerful than our instinct for self-preservation. So I think the Chinese philosopher Lao Tzu said this best. The Chinese philosopher Lao Tzu said, by being loving, we are capable of being brave. By being loving, we are capable of being brave. And over 2,000 years ago in the Art of War, Sun Tzu said, treat your soldiers as your children, and they will follow you into the deepest valleys. Treat your soldiers as your own beloved sons, and they will stand by you even unto death. So when people talk about love as naive and love is wimpy and love is weak, the military uses that bond of love to get soldiers to fight in battle. The most powerful force in the world is love. I heard a story on the radio that illustrates this. I heard a story on the radio about a 73-year-old woman, and she was walking on the street, and there was a loose pit bull running toward her. So what would you do if you were walking on the street and there was a loose pit bull running toward you? Would your instinct be to go and fight the pit bull? If you perceive it as aggressive, or to run away, or climb a tree, or jump on top of a car and get in the house. Get the safety, right? But this story was about a 73-year-old woman. True story. True story. She's walking her little dog, a little terrier. The pit bull runs up, clamps its jaws on her little dog. The 73-year-old woman bent down and bit the pit bull on the neck until the pit bull let go. She actually bit this pit bull to make it let go. And she was asked in an interview, the interviewer said, weren't you afraid? And she said, the only thing I was afraid of was my dog getting hurt. So when your loved one is threatened, you lose your regard for personal safety. Imagine if there was a wild animal attacking your child, your parent, your best friend, your spouse. You actually lose regard for your own personal safety, and you would go rush to protect your loved one. So if it's you and a wild animal, you and an attacker, you're afraid. But imagine a wild animal and attacker going after your child. You feel the surge of adrenaline, you lose regard for personal safety, you rush and you help your loved one. There was a story that Gavin DeBecker taught. He is the nation's leading expert on violence and violence prevention. He told a story about a woman who was getting into a car, and this man tried to carjack her. So she's getting into her car, she has the driver's side door open, he grabs onto her leg, she's kicking, he won't let go. She has her 2-year-old daughter in the back seat, and as he's grabbing onto her legs and he refuses to let go, she takes her car keys and gouges out both of his eyes. And Gavin DeBecker asked her afterward, he said, "Are you sorry about what you did to that man?" And she said, "Well, he got into a very dangerous situation. He attacked me when I had my little girl with me." And Gavin DeBecker said, "That's why men tend not to attack women who have their children with them." He said, "It's too damn dangerous." Right? Now, you see this in warfare, right? And then he used to move Forrest Gump. Why did Forrest Gump risk his life to save Bubba? There's bullets flying, explosions happening. Forrest Gump is running toward the bullets. He's running toward the explosions. Why is he doing that? They're best friends, right? So armies make soldiers love each other, then they will die for each other. So love of comrades is one psychological technique that the Greeks used to make soldiers fight and not run away. Another technique that you used was love of country. Love of country. So if you look at the Battle of Marathon, in 490 BC, there was a very large Persian navy, very large Persian military, very small Greek military. So the Greeks were greatly outnumbered. 10 years later, the Battle of the Salamis, a naval battle, you had a huge Persian navy, very small Greek navy. So this was the battle cry they used at the Battle of Salamis. The battle cry went, "Advance, ye sons of Greece, from oppression, save your wives, save your children, save your country. This day, the common cause of all demands your valor." Now, I think that battle cry has been used by every government since then, not word for word, but the essence of that battle cry. How many wars have there been in human history?
Gazillion.
Maybe thousands. But do you know in all of world history, in all of military history, there has never been a single war, not one war, where a national leader told his people they're fighting for money or gold or oil? Never before happened.
They never told them.
Even if it is about that, which often is. National leaders don't tell people that's what it's about.
Not even the conquest of the Spanish of South America?
Pardon?
Not even the conquest of South America by the Spanish?
So if you look at those kinds of conquests, colonialism, right? Look at the colonialism of the European nations. We are, according to them, this is their rhetoric, we're civilizing these people. We're saving their souls, right?
Yeah.
Look at South America. These people are conducting human sacrifice. These people are heathens. They're pagans. We are going to civilize them. We're going to give them civilization. They're savages. We're going to give them Christianity. We're going to save their souls. If you look at the rhetoric that the British used in India, right, we're civilizing these people. With the Roman Empire, we're civilizing people. We're bringing Roman civilization to others. Our civilization is superior. Theirs is inferior. They're barbarians, they're savages. We're bringing enlightenment, wisdom, good rule, order, justice.
Right?
Native Americans, same rhetoric, right? Think about how they would force convert these Native Americans. They would try to convert them to Christianity. They tried to make them adopt Western culture. So here's what governments say they're fighting about: freedom, peace, self-defense, protecting your country, protecting your family. Liberating people is a very common one. That goes back to ancient history. Cyrus the Great. Alexander the Great. Alexander the Great, he believed that humanity is one family. And as one family, humanity should live in peace together. But these people over here don't understand that yet, so I have to go conquer them and unify humanity. Right? Look at the rhetoric of the colonial powers. Right? The British, they see themselves as the beacon of what is good and just, civilization, what is moral, what is right, and they're spreading that around the world. Same thing with the ancient Greeks. If you look at how the Greeks perceived their culture, how the Romans perceived their culture, as just, as good, as moral, as order. as what the world needs to deal with chaos. Now, General MacArthur was very skeptical. He was very skeptical of the idea that humans are naturally violent. And he said that human beings have a deep craving for peace, a deep natural craving for peace. And he said that we know this because when any government in world history goes to war, doesn't matter what kind of government it is, they always say they're fighting for peace. Right? Now, I'm not saying the conquistadors weren't fighting for money. I'm not saying that. But when a government tries to sell something to their entire population, right, the conquistadors might have even been told they were fighting for money. But many of the conquistadors, they had some behavioral problems. They, if you look at their upbringing, if you look at if you look at some of their issues when they were younger, they had some issues. So the Nazis might tell the SS, we're fighting to kill these Jewish people, right? But when Hitler talks to the entire German population, he says something different, right? So the conquistadors might be told, hey, go kill these people, you get paid. But when it's being sold to the public, when Hitler gives a speech to the German people, he says something about peace and self-defense and freedom. But when he's talking to the Einsatzgruppen, or when Himmler is talking to the Einsatzgruppen, it might be a much different conversation. But that's a much smaller group of people. Some of them might have psychological issues. Some of them might have a little empathy. So when you try to sell it to the masses, though, you want to get maximum support for your war. So you want to have a very holy, noble message. So this is very important to think about, the power of love, how love is manipulated. If human beings are naturally violent, why would the greatest problem every army in world history be when a battle begins? How do you stop soldiers from running away? And why do governments have to manipulate our love in order to make us go to war? So I talked yesterday about loving your enemy. It's a very high ideal. I think a first step is respecting everybody. Respect is a precondition for empathy and for love. So if we can just have respect for everybody as humans, that's a practical step we can apply to our lives. Let me show you an example of the power of respect. I need to make it very clear that respect, this is not just something for activists. This is something people can use with their families, their friends, their co-workers, strangers, their adversaries. Remember I told that fork story yesterday? And how most human conflict comes from people feeling disrespect. And martial arts teaches the best self-defense is conveying respect. So here's a video, this shows how broadly respect can be applied, how broadly waging peace can be applied. And when you watch this video, I would even contend that police officers might be the people who most need waging peace training, right? So it's not just for activists or pacifists. Police officers, people in the workplace, right? People who work in the DMV, everybody can benefit from this kind of training. How do you convey respect? How do you calm people down? How do you resolve conflict? So this just shows how broad, how practical this tool really is.
Paul, is this where I need to turn?
Oh, this is fine. This video is on YouTube, so this is fine.
Can you turn on the light?
Oh, yes, sure. Please.
This is LA Sheriff's Deputy Elton Simmons. I bet you don't like him already. He's sitting there hiding in the shadows. I'm going to go catch some real criminals, you may be thinking. For no wonder he has a record number of complaints. Who wouldn't complain about a guy whose sole purpose in life is to ruin your tent? By the very nature of the business, all LA County traffic cops can expect to get at least a few complaints every year. A lot of them are petty, people just mad because they got a ticket. But regardless, they all get documented and placed in the officer's personnel file. Which is why Captain Pat Maxwell was stunned when he started looking through Simmons' file.
I just said that's not possible.
Although he did see lots of commendations, looking back over the last 20 years, over the last 25,000 traffic stops, Captain Maxwell couldn't find one complaint. A record. Zero.
I mean, Vegas or MIT do not give you the odds of the statistical probability of that.
Obviously, Elton is doing something right.
Something happened. It's got to be something.
You know what it is? No idea. Until the captain told him, Elton didn't even know he had such a record, let alone how he got it.
And just how I do it every day.
So we trailed him for a day to see if we could figure out how he does it.
Yeah, that's what I'm doing.
For first thing I noticed was that he has this pitch-perfect mix of authority and diplomacy.
I want to keep on your
own. None of the attitude that sometimes comes with a conflict.
That's okay. Let's just focus. Be careful. I'm here with you. I'm not up here. It's one thing I hate to be looked down at. I can't stand it. So I'm not going to look down at you.
That's fine. In lieu of a lecture, he gives most people the benefit of the doubt.
So it happens.
Of course, they still get the ticket.
It happens.
It's just not really. Drivers seem to appreciate it.
It's not mine.
So much of it, by the end, some are downright
spitting. My vision is a smile. Really got a great smile.
Really? You're giggling down.
Yeah, I've got a ticket. I've got a ticket. He's a nice guy. I'll be the
Disheartening, time after time.
Very, time.
Ticket after ticket.
Never so happy to get a ticket in my life.
All of these capital preconceptions. His boss says there's a lesson there for hard nosed traffic cops everywhere.
Their excuse is, well, I get tickets all day long. I'm going to get complaints. Well, that's not true. There's a way to do it, and Elton Simmons is the way.
Certainly. No complaints here. Steve Hartman, on the road in Los Angeles.
Yeah, I got it.
Now, if you look at the police issues in the U.S., respect, disrespect, these are behind what's going on, right? People feel disrespected. And people maybe aren't taught how to convey respect. Now, all of you have a conference coming up. You all have a Presbyterian
General
Assembly coming up. So this is something that could apply to that as well. Talking to people yesterday, I was taught that in these meetings, there's stress, people are frustrated, and these tools can be applied also in that environment. And I'll talk more about how that can be applied. So I want to talk more about empathy and respect by talking about aggression. And we'll tie that into empathy and respect. So let's say that you have a pack of wolves and a grizzly bear, and there's a dead deer, and the wolves are hungry, the grizzly bear is hungry. What usually happens? Dead deer, hungry grizzly bear, hungry wolves, they're both hungry. What usually happens?
The bear
gets eaten.
The bear sits on the deer. As much as he can for 3 days. Gets full, leaves.
That's a very good point. It depends. That could happen. That could happen. But it depends. But it depends on how big is the bear, how many wolves are there.
Yeah.
So if it's a small bear and 12 wolves, what if it's a big bear and 2 wolves? But how do they figure this out? They got to figure it out who's going to get to eat first. And who's going to get the leftovers if there are leftovers.
They flip for
it. They growl. They posture. Think about why does a bear roar? Why do wolves growl? They do something called posturing. The wolves will growl, the bear will roar. And through that posturing system, one animal will typically leave. Every animal in nature postures as their first method of self-defense. What do cats do? They hiss at you. That's a very good impression. Very good impression. Now, when you posture, you want to be bigger and be louder, right? So the cat, the tail will stick up, it arches its back, the hair will stand up, you want to be bigger and louder. A bear might stand up on 2 legs and roar. A cobra will lift up its body, spread its hood, show its fangs. A tarantula will lift up its front leg, show its fangs. A rattlesnake will curl up into a coil to look larger and shake its tail, right? Every animal in nature does it. Now, why do animals in nature do that? When a rattlesnake shakes its tail at you, what is it saying? Is it saying, come over here and pet me? It's saying, I don't want to have to bite you. Please leave me alone. I don't want to get in a fight with you. Now, why do animals in nature do that? Why don't they just go ahead and fight?
Self-preservation.
The reason is because in the wild, there are no hospitals. No hospitals, no emergency rooms. If you get injured and you lose the ability to run 35 miles an hour, you might starve to death. Now, animals have to hunt. A rattlesnake will hunt rodents. A wolf will hunt deer. But what if a rattlesnake is facing a wolf or a fox or a mountain lion? That's pretty dangerous. What if a wolf is facing a mountain lion or a bear? Very dangerous, right?
So animals prefer to posture as their first method of self-defense because violence in nature is very dangerous. Now, the human beings have this behavior. Human beings posture all the time. What are examples of human beings posture? Stand up tall. What's two men or two women about to get into a fight? They stand up tall, put out their chest, and yell. And one man might push the other man to show them how strong he is. Do you ever see two men about to get into a fight walk up to each other like this? Never happens, right? You instinctually know. Stand up tall, put out your chest, be loud. Intimidate that person, he'll walk away. Get scared. Now, think about the ancient battles. Why did the Romans and Greeks have those big helmets with the plume coming up the top? What's the point of that? Why did they go into battle screaming? Yeah, look tall. If you see the soldiers in front of the British palace, they got that big black to look tall, right? In ancient battles, soldiers would go into battle screaming at the top of their lungs. Makes you winded screaming like that, but they would do that to posture. Now, this is why the gun became such a popular weapon. Many of you are interested in the issue of guns. This is why the gun is such a popular weapon. It's because it makes so much noise. So if you look at the early musket, the longbow and crossbow had longer range, higher firing rate, and better accuracy than the early musket. But the early musket made more noise. So even though it wasn't accurate, it made more noise. So if you're with an early musket going bang, 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 and a guy with a bow and arrow is going point, 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 the guy with a bow and arrow runs away. Lieutenant Colonel Dave Grossman calls this the bigger bang theory. The bigger bang theory, whatever army has louder noise has the same psychological advantage in the battlefield. Now let me show you an example, because seeing is believing. So here's an example. Watch this between bears and wolves. Now, if posturing doesn't work, animals have two options. Let's say posturing doesn't work. That's their first method of self-defense. If posturing doesn't work, they have two options. What are their two options? Attack or run away, right? So this is what they prefer to do. If this doesn't work, they attack or they run. Now, here is a video of wolves and bears. Watch how none of the animals get bit this entire video. Is there a way to turn this sound?
Yeah, it's not coming back. Hold on just a second.
Sure. I got one technical.
What was working before has stopped working. Hold on. There, now it's coming.
Okay, great.
Be just a sec. And you want the sound up on that mic?
On the video. Yeah, just a little bit, please. I'm turning it more. Oh, my goodness. And the grizzly is accustomed to taking what he wants. The hanging wolves size up the situation. The pack is not a little strong, and the bear is not as big as he could be. He's trying to bury the carcass and defends it from the center of his earthworks. It's his strength against their speed. But the wolves seem to think they can take it. The Haydens proved to be more than the young bear can handle.
Here's another video, and that shows even in nature, animals are afraid of getting injured, just like humans are. Right. Here's another example.
Each encounter in Yellowstone presents a critical choice. What is brave one moment is foolish the next. To fight or to flee, all of life hangs on the decision. With two wolves out on the prowl, a mother elk weighs her options carefully. The wolves have seen her, but not her calf. Is too young to outrun the wolves. Its only defense is to hide and keep completely still. His mother heads straight for the wolves. Her purpose is to distract them, to keep their attention entirely on her. Again and again she charges, then invites them to chase her, using the river as a safe retreat. She can play this game against true wolves. She would never attempt this with an entire wolf pack. Frustrated, the wolves give up. The calf owes its life to the tactics and the courage of its mother. Motherhood, even for a grizzly bear, is a test of character. It's June, and a spring snowstorm has kicked up. But the bear and her cub are confronting more than the weather. Wolves from the druid pack have caught them out in the open. In the tug of war between grizzlies and wolves, the wolves attack where they can. They are after the cub. They can kill it. They will eliminate a future rival. She's not a big bear, but she stands her ground. The wolves won't risk an injury. Then suddenly, it's over. The wolves make a decision, and the bears are free to go. As the two dominant predators.
All right, let me show you one more example. This might strike closer to home. Chimpanzees, yes. How intelligent that deer was. Just and the courage protecting your loved ones, right? Like humans. Yeah. So chimpanzees, look at how terrified these chimpanzees are of this leopard. And you see behavior that looks almost like human behavior, right? Throwing things, making noise, jumping up and down, right?
A mechanical leopard was instrumental in an experiment with chimpanzees conducted by scientists from the University of Amsterdam. Anthropologists have long puzzled over how our ancestors defended themselves against predators. How could such small creatures, not yet intelligent enough to make stone weapons, have possibly survived? Leopards are natural predators of chimpanzees. Here is the chimp's attack. We catch a glimpse of how our ancestors have left the safety of the trees
may have first met the challengers of life on the ground.
All right. So, let's see. Think of aggression as like the heat from a fire.
So think of aggression as like the heat from a fire. It's the manifestation of a deeper phenomenon. It's the symptom of a deeper phenomenon. So what are the fires that cause human aggression? If I perceive you as a human and all I see is your aggression, I have very little empathy for you. But if I look at you as a human and I say, well, actually, your aggression is caused by fear, deep down you're afraid. Now it's much easier for me to have empathy for someone who's afraid. Right? And then if I have empathy for you and your fear, I can say, well, why are you afraid? What can I do to help alleviate your fear? Or if I look at you as a human and I perceive you on the surface, well, you're aggressive, you're being a jerk, right? Mm-hmm. That's another form of dehumanization. You're a jerk, very dismissive comment. If I perceive, well, actually beneath that aggression, you feel disrespected. It's much easier for me to have empathy for someone who feels disrespected. Then I can ask myself, well, why do you feel disrespected? What can I do to help make you feel more respected? So what are the fires that cause human aggression? Let's write some of these down really quickly. So what are some of the fires that cause human aggression? So empathy is seeing people on this deeper level. So we have fear. The most common cause of human aggression, or the most common cause of human conflict, disrespect. Protecting your loved one. What are other fires?
Anger.
So think of anger as aggression. What makes people angry? So anger is the surface. I'm angry. That's the heat from the fire. That's the surface you're seeing. Why am I angry? Am I afraid? Am I disrespected? Do I feel frustrated? Frustration, does that make people aggressive? Have any of you ever wanted to break your computer before? What else? What about humiliation?
Jealousy.
Vulnerability. What about insecurity? Insecurity. What about betrayal? What about confusion? Many, many causes. So this is all about seeing people on deeper levels. Now, here's a question. Can you be aggressive today because of something that happened to you when you were 4 years old? Yes. So a major cause of aggression is trauma. Right? You can be aggressive because something happened to you 20 years ago. So let's talk about trauma. All of you heard of Mike Tyson?
Yeah.
What do you know about Mike Tyson?
Right.
Whenever I ask this question, first thing people say is someone's hero. So do you ever wonder why he's like that? Why is he the way that he is? There's a story, there's a quote from Eleanor Jean Hoffman. She said, an enemy is someone whose story you have not heard. An enemy is someone whose story you have not heard. So many of you care about prison reform. And if we want to deal with prison reform, we have to deal with underlying causes of violence. But why is he like that? Why is he so aggressive? So Mike Tyson, he talks about, there's a great documentary about him called Tyson, directed by James Toback. And the documentary, Tyson talks about how as a child he was terrified of fighting. And he was picked on all the time as a kid because he said he was short, he was fat, and he wore glasses. And kids would pick on him all the time. And the first time he ever got into a fight, these bullies took his glasses, put his glasses in the middle cart, and he just ran away. He was so terrified. Now, the first time he had ever been in a fight, he was about 10 years old. And he used to raise these pigeons. These pigeons were his source of comfort because his mother was a prostitute.
He never knew his father. It was rumored his father was pimp. He grew up in a really broken home. And so he used to raise his pigeons. And when he was around 10 years old, he fully found his pigeons. And he said, give me my bird back. And the bully ripped the bird's head off and threw it out. And Mike Tyson beats up this bigger kid. And ever since then, he's had all these rage problems. By the time he was 13 years old, he'd been arrested, I believe, I think it was dozens of times by the time he was 13. Now, here's a video of him talking. And he's saying, as a man in his 40s, he has not gotten over being bullied as a child. And look at how intelligent he is, how articulate he is, his ability to introspect. For a man with a, you know, elementary school education, he's very intelligent. But his ability to be honest, to self-reflect, that's critical for self-improvement. But even as a man in his 40s, he has not gotten over being bullied as a child. And how many people who commit violence are actually wounded people, right?
I still don't have it. Okay. Hold on just a second. I think it's because I'm overheating it.
Okay. I just got a couple more videos to show.
There it is. Okay, now it's coming. I don't know what to
do. Because
I know.
Yeah,
I know.
That'd be fine.
Yep.
My life is I can't be like the rest of the guy. I can't come out and party after the show and stuff. I can't. I can't do it. Wait, I'm gonna get in trouble, get locked up, get shot. So I gotta stay home. I have to pretty much isolate my family pretty much. I don't do well outside with people who call them massive. Be abusive to me. I might be abusive to somebody. I prefer this child. I keep my peace. I like this being with my family. Yeah.
You mean now?
Yeah.
You think you still have the potential to be, forgive me, crazy Mike Tyson? If you got into the wrong company?
Absolutely, 100%. I'll be too sensitive. I think somebody's picking at me and making fun of me.
Really?
And I'll be sensitive probably. Yeah, absolutely.
Well, let me ask you a personal question. If I ask a question that hits you the wrong way, is there a chance
I'm
going to wind up on the
floor? This is interesting. I'm a human being. We're human beings. And I know I'm a public figure, but I'm still a human being. And I'm not perfect. So if I'm not in the proper mood or the proper setting, I may not be this guy that you see in front of you. Like, if I think I'm being picked on, I still have that baggage of a little kid being picked on. I still have that baggage. I've never let it. So a person could get looking at me and say, oh, that's my baggage. And I might be offensive. I might think he's laughing at me.
You're serious?
Yeah. I got some really issues that I got to work on.
So let me show you another video. I was talking with Alonzo yesterday about dehumanization. We were talking about also how insecurity can make people aggressive, jealousy. So here's a clip from that comedy show, Key and Peele. It's a comedy skit because, of course, in real life, most people aren't this introspective. Now, if everybody was this introspective, things would be different in our world. But this just shows what's going on behind the mind of the bully.
Much stronger enough to set up queer. understand why. I mean, why you gotta go there?
I've been having sexual fantasies about some of the other guys in school. Why me? I'm afraid of these feelings and what they might mean. It's like, because I hate myself so much, I gotta point that hate outward towards you.
Coach, that is on such a deep level of tolerance.
Then I'm gonna punish you physically for acknowledging my emotional problem.
I'm gonna say you don't understand yourself so well, then maybe you should try working on changing it.
Of course I wanna change it. But it's the only defense mechanism I have against deeper, more terrifying problems buried inside of me. Look at my dad's here. Forget the damn Tulsa. I need to take you home and beat on you because I hate myself. And you look like your mama would have been. But I'm caught out the guilt I'm feeling with mistreating you. But I'm gonna go after you. I'm gonna internalize that and unknowingly transfer it onto you.
Any thoughts, Rufus?
Any thoughts,
Rufus? It's very, very revealing. Now, this technique, empathy, love, the most powerful force in the world. Military history proves that. It's the foundation of strategic thinking, especially for waging peace. It allows you to deal with people more realistically, more effectively. Now, if somebody's aggressive, why are they aggressive? Are they afraid? I can have much more empathy for someone who's afraid. Now, this is also useful for ourselves. If I get aggressive, why am I aggressive? Why am I angry? Do I feel frustrated? Am I reacting to the trauma from my life? Am I afraid? Do I feel disrespected? Do I feel humiliated? Am I angry about something that happened 9 hours earlier at work? Right? Think about people who come home from work and take out their anger on their spouse. So this allows you to be more self-reflective. You realize, well, my anger, my aggression is by the heat from a deeper fire. And when I feel angry or aggressive, what's making me feel that way, right? And that empowers you to deal with the problem. And it helps you not take it out on other people. And if you do take it out on other people, we all have a bad day. Once in a while, we say, yeah, I apologize. I shouldn't have treated you like that. And it wasn't you. I was angry about something else. I didn't mean to take it out on you. I'm sorry. So that awareness, this cultivates our awareness of ourselves and cultivates our awareness of others. It's very critical for waging peace, it's very critical for the art of living, it can help in the General Assembly, it can help in all walks of life. Maybe we have time for just a couple thoughts, maybe for 1 or 2 minutes. Any thoughts before we go to a break? Power of empathy, power of love, the anatomy of aggression, how aggression functions. Now when people are posturing, you go, oh, they're posturing. I know what that is. Why are they posturing? What's the fire beneath them? And you might not ever know what it is. They might not know. But you give them the benefit of the doubt. That's what it is. Like, that doesn't mean you will know what's making them aggressive. They might not even be aware of it. But you give them the benefit of the doubt. If this person was truly happy, they would be acting like this. Maybe they're having a bad day, right? Maybe they're having a bad year. Maybe they got some issues. You might not know what's causing you. You might never know. They might not know. But give them the benefit of the doubt. Know that if they're feeling this kind of aggression, they're in some kind of pain. They're in some kind of discomfort, some kind of turmoil. And have empathy for them being in that state of pain, right? Being aggressive doesn't feel all that good, being angry all the time, right? It's not only bad for your psychology, it's scientifically proven to be bad for your health. To be angry all the time actually harms your physical health. So have empathy for being imminent, for them being in a state of discomfort.
So my frustration is that I feel like many people in leadership positions egg people on to act on their worst instincts.
Interesting.
And so
repeat it.
So whether it's gay bashing or whether it's racial thing or whatever it is, that I feel like there are people who get in the leadership position. So I grew up in the South during the 50s and 60s, and so I grew up in Arkansas, and our governor was Quavis, and when we came to integrate the schools, he did everything he could to encourage people to fight against integrating the schools.
and basically encourages people to act on their worst instincts instead of their best instincts. And so how do you deal with that? People in leadership that I think are not, you know, who are basically using people's bad instincts as a way of gaining power or approval.
Yeah, that's a great question. One thing I teach is peace leadership, and most people don't have leadership training. So that's very bad leadership that you're seeing.
Right.
And as you know, and a lot of people though don't know proper leadership skills. They don't know how to lead by example. They don't know what makes leaders very effective. And a lot of people have no conflict resolution skills, and they think that they might have to use fear and these kind of tactics to be effective. It really depends upon the leader. I think that we have to give people leadership training and training in how to live, how to wage peace, so people have more tools. And a lot of it has to do with the character of the person and the training that person has and why they're behaving like that. So I can offer later on some good leadership examples. I think people very rarely see really good leadership examples. So I can offer, I have a really good video actually of leadership is the opposite of that. And it's a video of a teacher. And teaching is a leadership position, certainly. It's definitely a leadership position. So I would like to show that video where you can just see the opposite extreme, where rather than trying to evoke conflict amongst people, this leader, this teacher goes out of his way to prevent conflict among people and to resolve conflict among people. But a lot of people don't have the tools, I think. A lot of people just don't have the knowledge or the training or the tools of how we can resolve this. So I'd like to focus on that after the break.
Yeah, I think one of the things that I'm reading a book right now, Nationalism, the sort of collapse of states, part of the collapse of Yugoslavia. And I think one of the things that the leaders on both sides, the pro-left Serbian thing, really were trying to exploit people's fear, to encourage people's fear, to get themselves more power. Because in one particular area, so there's a 20% rate of intermarriage between Serbs and Croats. And then, so obviously, people didn't generally hate each other. The leaders on both sides said, well, you can't really trust those other people. And the warlords took over because people thought that's the only people that could really trust them.
Wow, that's a great point. Let me address that very briefly, and then we'll go to a break. That's such a good point. It ties into empathy. So when I talk people, we have to refute this myth that empathy is weak and wimpy and naive. Empathy is extremely powerful. One reason we know empathy is extremely powerful is because people in power fear empathy. They're afraid of it. They do not want the oppressed to empathize with each other. They want to divide and conquer. It's easier to divide and conquer. Empathy is very dangerous. If you have the poor white people empathizing with the black people, that's extremely dangerous, right? If you have the poor white people empathizing with the Mexican immigrants and the teachers' union, that's very, very dangerous, right? Imagine if all the poor white people in America, that Martin Luther King Jr. called the forgotten white poor, imagine if they empathized with black people and Mexican immigrants. And they said, we're in the same boat together, right? So you want to divide and conquer. Now here's a great quote from The Grapes of Wrath. Fantastic quote from The Grapes of Wrath about the power of empathy. One man, one family driven from the land, this rusty car creaking along the highway to the west. I lost my land. A single tractor took my land. I am alone and I am bewildered. And in the night, one family camps in the ditch and another family pulls in and the tents come out. The two men squat in their hams and the women and children listen. Here is the node. You who hate change and fear revolution. Keep these two squatting men apart. Make them hate, fear, suspect each other. Here is the onlodge of the thing you fear. This is the zygote. For here I lost my land is changed. A cell is split and from its splitting grows a thing you hate. We lost our land. The danger is here. For two men are not as lonely and perplexed as one. And from this first weed there grows a still more dangerous thing. I have a little food, plus I have none. If from this problem the sum is we have a little food, the thing is on its way, the movement has direction.
Only a little multiplication now, and this land, this tractor, are ours. The two men squatting in a ditch, the little fire, the side meat stewing in a single pot, the silent stone-eyed women. Behind, the children listening with their souls to words their minds do not understand. The night draws down. The baby has a cold. Here, take this blanket. It's wool. It was my mother's blanket. Take it for the baby. This is the thing to bomb. This is the beginning from I to we. That's why governments do that, divide and conquer. Okay? And we'll talk more about that in the group discussion. So that's all I have. Do you want to talk about the books briefly?
Thank you all for being here. And we're inviting you all to address you so much. I really appreciate that. I've been meeting with Paul for about 8 years now. And so it's so thrilling for me to see him address all of you here. He's written some amazing books. He has over here The Art of Waiting Peace, which is divided into two sections. The first is called The Infinite Shield, and the second is called The Sword of Truth. So please help yourself and take a look at his book and the concepts he's talked about here today are also in the book in greater detail. And if you appreciated his talk, I know you will really, really appreciate his book. So thank you so much for inviting me here. Thank you.
What's your name?
Oh, I'm Joanne Depp. So thank you.
Yeah, so the thing is, I'm a terrible salesman. I'm terrible with promotion.
It's a book available electronically.
It is. Yeah. And I work really hard on these books, and I don't have any need to promote them well. It just sounds self-serving, and it's one of my weaknesses that I can't promote myself. I can promote other people's books, but it just feels weird to me. It's just like sticking my right foot in my left shoe. So
it's okay, Paul, it's kind of endearing.
Yeah.
So, thanks for letting me know it's available.
Hey, Paul, can I just ask a question?
Yes.
I'm hoping that when we come back, one of the things you can address is, in your mind, what happens when we go from the individual that you've been focusing on this morning to the communal, right? How do we as an organization or we as individuals confront systems that function without empathy or the ability to empathize?
That sounds great.
So, can you come back to that?
And the reason Joanne mentioned the books is because they're going to be gone after lunch. That's why she mentioned that. Because I can't bring them back with me, so when they leave this afternoon, taking them with them. So if you wanted to buy one, they'll be gone after this. So, and that's the best I can do.
So we'll have to come back at 10 after 11.
I'm grateful.
I don't do that.
All right.
I don't do that. Twitter. Do you Twitter?
Yes, I've been tweeting.
Our daughter decided we should have an iPad for Christmas. And I go, why? We have a laptop. Well, no, you should have it. And you should learn how to Twitter. You do this. And I said, no, I don't. I don't want to complicate, clutter up my life. When you're pushing 75, you know that your days are still those days with the new feeling. I've never brought myself to
I'm
Thank you. Now, there's that. To reconvene in small groups, 6 or 7 people, so you can rearrange chairs and get into small circles. So we're moving into small group conversations. We're going to do this for about 30 minutes. So you want to rearrange your chairs so that you have 6 or 7 people in a group.
Seeing aggression, seeking a fire. What fire is the cause of aggression? If any of you want to begin with this topic, if you aren't sure what to talk about, list ways of conveying respect in the family context, in the work context, in the General Assembly. Maybe some of you have some personal stories. But we covered a lot of topics, so there's plenty to talk about. And that's a starting point, because this is something that we can apply right now. Right? So go ahead and feel free, and we'll go to 11:30. Thank you.
Annoying me. with your business.
It's not going to matter in 7 minutes.
And this part of the law is
the vision of the
Absolutely. Thank you.
So let's gather back together as one group. And Paul has some more to share with us and also entertain your questions.
Are you going to need more video? Just make sure it's still blinking, so it'll come up when we're ready. And have we hit the one that you're concerned about not showing?
No, I didn't show it.
Okay.
Would it be possible to turn it down a little bit?
Turn it down?
I'll
the video one?
The video one. I was in trouble getting it higher. Can you turn it up one? I guess it looks like it goes. But it was really bad. I don't know what the deal is.
I'll play with it when you're ready.
Everybody come back. Everybody come back. Everybody come back in, please.
Hey, everybody, come on back to the conversation, please.
You started this.
Everybody eating about that? Let's go ahead.
Yeah. Okay.
All right, so I'll cover a couple more things, but what I'm covering is actually a question that got asked earlier about leadership. So I wanted to briefly offer a couple universal leadership principles that apply, and we can do questions and answers more after that. So to cover these leadership principles, I want to show a couple of videos. Now, this first video I'm going to show I really like because it shows the power of rehumanization. I think we might forget how badly Asians were dehumanized in American history because the U.S. government fought three consecutive wars against Asians, Japanese in World War II, North Koreans and Chinese in the Korean War, and Vietnamese in the Vietnam War. Growing up in the 80s looking Asian, I got picked on a lot. So this shows the power of rehumanization by showing a Japanese classroom of elementary school students, fourth graders. And it shows our shared humanity. It shows that there are cultural differences, but we have this common shared humanity. And also, it's going to illustrate some of these leadership principles that I want to talk about. And these videos, I think, will make you more hopeful about humanity, which is good, especially nowadays. So I'll show a few clips from this documentary. It's called Children Full of Life. And we'll talk about what do we all have in common as humans.
This is the Minelli for the Student Palace of a Municipal Elementary School, Grade 4, Class 1. It's April 2002, a new school year. Grade 3 is past, failed, but not forgotten. Here's someone from that minute. They're overjoyed to see their homeroom teacher, Mr. Toshiro Kanemori, same as last one, the best, kind, and tough. But this sounds strange as a Western view. The class goal from grade 4 is to understand how to live a happy life, how to care for other people.
All right, now this next clip is where it starts to get interesting because he uses that we all want to be happy to build empathy. Now, the leadership principle I want to focus on is if you ignore it, you condone it. If you ignore it, you condone it.
So in the Army, you can get in trouble even if you don't cause a problem. Because if something bad happens, your commander will say, well, what could you have done that you didn't do that could have prevented the problem? So you are held accountable for your inaction. Which I think is very unusual, right? Because in our culture, we say, well, I didn't cause it. It's not my fault. It's not my responsibility.
So in the military, you're held accountable not only for your action, but also for your inaction. Well, you didn't cause it, but you could have been proactive, you could have done something to prevent it, right? So you can get in trouble for actually being inactive, for not being proactive. Now, if you're in the military and you're walking by some soldiers and you hear them telling racist jokes or sexist jokes, if you don't correct them, in their mind, you condone their behavior. And they might be telling those jokes in your shot at you to see how you're going to react to it. So if you walk by soldiers telling racist jokes or sexist jokes, you have to correct them. If you ignore it, you are telling them, you can do that. It's fine. So whenever you see injustice, you have to confront it. Now, this is true on the personal level. This is true on the international level. Right? If you ignore injustice, you are condoning it. And this is what Martin Luther King Jr. talked about, what Howard Zinn has talked about, is that when you are apathetic to injustice, you are siding with the oppressor. If you are apathetic to injustice, you are not neutral. You are actually taking the oppressor's side. Because apathy, silence, it always helps the oppressor. And that's what King and Howard Zinn have both discussed. So he emphasizes that here, where he talks to the students and where, even if they didn't cause the problem, he holds them accountable for their inaction. And imagine how different our culture would be if we had that ideal, that you're not only accountable for your actions, you're also accountable for your inaction. Now, none of us are Amnesty International. We can't take on every single issue, but many of us are focusing on some sort of injustice, dedicating our time to it, and doing the best we can. And that's really the key to addressing all these issues.
Japanese language class. The character means to write or unfold. Kanemaru says he evolved from the image of the word carrying an unborn
child.
Good teachers connect theory with life. June, halfway through the first semester, and about a nasty one. A few children are being teased, bullied. The bullies laugh at their test scores and make up stories about them. It's vicious and destructive, and Kanemaru says it has to be talked out and stopped cold right now. Bullying is contempt and hatred, completely indefensible.
Hondai, teibetsu shiteita tomoto wa imasen. Hondai wa. Hondai wa, soi mono o nakama to wa iwanasu. Iwanasu. Jibun no naka ni aru tomodachi o misagete iru kokoro to mukiatte morau.
Fine, as far as it goes, but nobody's admitted to anything. Kanemaru wants the bullies to confess and explain their behavior.
Sama
cannot.
Nobody admits anything. Can memories add enough?
There's no look on it, you know. Not many people say that.
きれいごとでごまかすつもりか君たちは自分のことをやっぱり棚上げしていってんじゃないか今の言い方だったらずっとさっきからずっと抜けてるのはこれだよ そのことばっかり言わないで 自分やってたよ誰も言ってないじゃないですか覚悟すぎるんだよ勉強できないから笑っていたでしょ自分がちゃいますか風呂入らない言ってたでしょ聞いてたでしょ広めたでしょちゃいますかここにいる多くの人は
Kanemori tells his grade fours to think it over and get out the notebooks. The discussion goes on for days, and slowly some truths come creeping out.
それに噂を止めることができなかったんだけど、私の噂を読めた軽い気持ちで一人の女の子に噂を読めた。すごくひどいことをした。私は軽蔑はされてないから、そのショックの気持ちは分からない。だから軽蔑しまったんだなと思いました。私だって無視したり、軽蔑したりしていた。私が悪い。
Today, the discussion spills over into lunchtime. And then Ayami Yamada stands up and talks about life as a target.
I think. 今思って私はその気持ちが分かっててそれでまた保育園の頃に母親の頃みたいにみんなにいじめられるのが怖くて
She knew how much it hurt to be picked on, laughed at. It hurt so much, she was afraid to shelter someone else. She was remorseful. The lesson, we're all vulnerable. We must admit it and go on.
All right, so I...
Maybe I don't need this. Actually, I think you do this.
Okay.
Is it on? I think a lot of teachers would have just let that go. But he goes on for days about the issue and confronts the issue. And I think he confronts it in the way where it has to be confronted. You have to address people's inaction. Now, it also shows our shared humanity. When I talk about trauma and bullying and humiliation, it doesn't matter what culture you're from. This affects all cultures, people in all cultures. The second
leadership level, I want to talk about mindfulness.
Yeah.
Okay. Second leadership.
Keep going.
Okay. So second leadership principle I want to talk about is praise in public, punish in private. You never want to publicly humiliate anybody if you are a leader. This is central to military leadership. You always want to praise in public. If somebody does something good, you tell everybody about it. Tell it in front of the whole unit. If you do something bad, you do it in private. You never want to publicly humiliate people. Now, why does the military do that? Doesn't that seem weird? The military, Does it seem weird that the military teaches some conflict resolution skills and the military teaches you not to publicly humiliate people? Why does the military do that?
Team building.
Team building?
Yeah.
Think of it practically, right?
Yeah.
These are all trained killers, right? These are people with weapons. You humiliate somebody, they might kill you, right? Conflict is extremely dangerous when you have people armed with weapons and they're trained how to kill people, right? You humiliate people, you disrespect people, you don't lead by example, you're a hypocrite. Your soldiers might shoot you in the back and kill you. And that happens a lot in warfare. They estimated, for various reasons, around 10 to 15% of the officers killed in Vietnam were killed by their own soldiers, right? They can kill you if they want to. And they outnumber you. So if you are a leader and you're bullying people and disrespecting people and humiliating people, and these aren't little children, these are grown men with weapons, right? And you're in a heat of combat where people don't know what's going on, they can just shoot you right in the back. Now, praise in public, punish in private. Think about how much conflict we could avoid if people did that. Don't humiliate people, right? Say good things in public. Privately, you handle the problems. You don't try to embarrass people. Now, he breaks this rule. But the reason he breaks this rule is because he wants the students to react to it. I think the only reason he can do this is because he's a 10th degree black belt teacher. He's really good at, well, I would never try to do this. But also, he's had these students for 2 years. He knows them really well. He knows how they're going to react. And he does it to get them to react to what he's doing, to oppose him. So watch this scene where he does this and breaks this rule, knowing the students are going to react to him.
They don't
laugh. Oh, by the way, I forgot to mention, one thing he does, he has all the students write a journal entry every day. And every day he'll have 3 students read a journal entry, volunteer to read it. That gives the students a way to express themselves. And it also gives them a way to introspect. And I think that's a very useful tool that he uses.
The rats are the fair work. They designed them, scrounged the materials, built them by themselves. And today they're all at school, a half hour early for the final pre-launch checks. It's a long way to the fifth period. And there's trouble when they get there. Mr. Kamimori is furious. Yuto Araki has been chattering and goofing around all morning. Mr. Kamimori's warned him it didn't work. Everybody rafts like you do. He stays on shore. The plus one doesn't accept that. Yo Enomoto was in the same raft with on team as user. And he's first on his feet to take on the teacher. This is a very dangerous challenge to a powerful authority. Yoga is frightened, but he keeps going. Chokes up, and the classmate moves in to help.
So
Any thoughts or reactions?
Really inspiring. It's inspiring how they humanize these people. They don't portray them as perfect, right? They bully each other sometimes, and but you see their humanity really come through.
And I like showing that very first clip because you think he's going to be all touchy-feely, and he's a really strict disciplinarian, right? But that really ties into what we're going to focus on next, the importance of leading by example. If you ignore it, you condone it, and how this applies to activism. And also, I think this ties into how we dehumanize children. We treat children like they're stupid. Those are fourth graders. That would be impressive for adults to do that.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
But look at how morally responsible children can be, but we treat them like they're stupid. And you create kind of a self-fulfilling prophecy where if you don't treat people like they have the possibility to be mature and responsible, they act immature because you treat them like they're immature. But those are fourth graders, and you see how we often dehumanize children. We treat them like they're children rather than treating them as morally responsible human beings who can think critically, who can oppose injustice, who know right from wrong. And how do we lead by example to instill that?
The fact that the teacher was willing to spend time and let the children spend time thinking and, you know, analyzing in whatever ways that they could what was wrong, they were able to come to their own solution. Most of us want instant solutions.
Yes, instant solutions.
Yeah.
Now, the next topic, we're going to tie some of this to nonviolence now. So this is what Gandhi and Martin Luther King Jr. believed. They believe that nonviolence is better than violence, but violence is better than apathy. So what does that mean? Violence is better than doing nothing. If your only options are do violence or do nothing, you should do violence. I'm going to show a video that illustrates that. So in this video, I'm going to show how you're going to see people who witness injustice, and you're going to see people who do nothing about it, and you're going to see people who threaten violence. And even if you're a pacifist, I think you will admire the people who threaten violence more than the people who do nothing. So some of these people don't have the best tools. They might use offensive language. They might threaten to beat somebody up. They might call the person a jerk. But at least they're doing something. They're not just standing there and doing nothing. And Gandhi thought that it's easier to empower those people with nonviolent tools because those people, they at least have the motivation. So they have the motivation, something's wrong, here's a better toolkit to deal with what's wrong. The people who don't care, it's really hard to give people that motivation. So watch this video. This video will also show how if you ignore it, you condone it. And watch the people who do nothing. And watch the people who threaten violence and who are disrespectful. Maybe that's the best toolkit they have. But you can at least admire their motivation to do the right thing. So this is from the show, What Would You Do? Any of you seen that show?
Yeah.
So it's a show where there's a hidden camera. And the
person being abused is an actor, and the abuser is an actor. So the person being abused is an actor, it's a man with Down syndrome, and the abuser is an actor, and they want to see how people are going to react to it, if they're going to step in and do anything.
We wonder, what will customers do when confronted with this kind of intolerance?
You have to go faster.
This woman is shocked, but will she stand up or judge?
They shouldn't hurt you. Their reactions are slow, you know what I mean?
She backs down. Why didn't you tell her? Why didn't you confront her, get her face?
Well, I just didn't want to get involved too much with that. I mean, she can lash out at me in any kind of way, and that's what I'm trying to avoid.
Back at the checkout counter, Josh is doing a fine job backing. And yet,
I hope this line goes fast, though. You know,
how will this customer respond to a whispered criticism?
So they take forever.
She seems to agree.
It takes a lot out of our day to wait for them to do what they're going to do. I mean, we could have already had lunch. This is ridiculous.
She later told us she didn't like how Josh was treated, but she doesn't regret her silence.
I feel it wasn't my right to say anything to her, because, you know, something we just have to let us stay.
When we're silent, our silence condones the language.
Madeline Will is with the National Down Syndrome Society.
It's important to say again and again, this is wrong. This is not fair. This is not how we treat other people. Kind of pick a reason, right?
But experts say slurs like these are used all too often.
We're going to have to double this. You heard of doubling?
We wonder.
Can you believe I hired these people?
Will anyone fight for Josh? And then along comes this woman.
Oh, no. Did you just say that? Right? Aren't you? Can you just speed it up a little bit more, please?
There's something dreadfully wrong with you. You and me, yeah, with you. How can you say that? If that was my child, I'd like that you.
I don't treat people like that, ever. It's heartbreaking. It's just heartbreaking to see people do that.
Heartbreaking enough just to hear this. But imagine if you're Josh.
It's not like to treat people like us and have Down syndrome like that.
So to her, you would say,
thank you.
He's hard, y'all. He's so stupid.
But the abuse continues.
Look how fast I do. Look. See? Just like that.
This time with teenage actors. Will the reaction be any different?
Retarded kid can't do anything.
Not nice.
It's an enemy.
What's this woman? She sends a silent message of support to Josh.
Should we let this guy work here?
He's got nice support. Somebody's got it. Somebody's got it.
And from way back there, this man comes up and steps right in.
I mean, seriously, who gave this guy a job? Get out of here, man. What are you going to be for this guy? Get out of the store. You got to keep this guy out of the store right now. Are you going to sell him this stuff? Yeah, get out of the store. You're an ass. Get out of here. You should be ashamed of yourself.
He circles around the checkout line to comfort Josh. It turns out Kevin Lynn knows all too well how deep this can be.
Casually made me mad.
He has a sister with Down syndrome.
I've heard people like that.
So your sister?
Yeah, say stuff like that to my sister and degrade her in that way. And I mean, it's crazy, you know? She can do so many of the same things that everybody else can.
The cruelty continues.
Can you go any slower?
And this man just keeps his head down. But little do we know, we're about to get a piece of this woman's mind.
Just look at that. Are you kidding? Because if you're not kidding, I'll get laid to punch you out.
Hurry up!
Just shove the stuff up here and get out.
But Chili Kitty thinks I'm the store manager. I'm not worried. Are you okay?
There's a customer here who's abusing me. He was making fun of me. He's criticizing me. He's cursing me.
That's what he can tell about how her. What would you do to experiment? So you weren't afraid that he might turn on you?
When I get that angry, when it has to do with injustice, I really don't care. If I got punched out, I got punched out. It just doesn't matter.
But while most customers have no problems adding up to the teenagers,
come on, retard, let's go.
Will they be so fearless with this intimidating actor?
It can take you up. You got a retard working.
This man stays quiet.
Put the eggs in separate bags.
Thank you. And watch this man's expression. He says a few words on his reacts.
Thank you, sir.
But while the men mostly stand down,
you believe this?
No, I think you are disgusting.
The women stand up. Angela Capone says it's not Josh who is the problem, it's the man abusing him.
Some people you can see the disabilities, some people you can't.
We fell for two long days, 30 different scenarios, and no one responded with more eloquence than this one.
How would you feel if that was your son or your daughter? How would you feel if that was you? He's a person, the same as you and I, with feelings.
Yeah, but they have places for the entire people. Thank you.
Yeah, and they should have places for people like you. It's time for you to meet your maker. I hope he remembers how you were.
Her name is Karen, and she's taught children with special needs.
I'm a school teacher. Everybody deserves an education. Everybody deserves a job. Everybody deserves a chance in this life. And you should be ashamed of yourself.
By the time I step in, Karen is shaking.
You got in his face.
I don't know about you, but I have nerves. I'm sensitive.
And there's one more reason Karen is so deeply moved. Meet Elvis.
He does an amazing job here. And he's a hard worker. And he's a great person.
He really does work at the store and also has special needs. The store's owners.
What kind of employees? Elvis is
the best.
I see him in action all the time. And, he's always busy. He's a busy guy.
And yet customers often abuse Elvis, using the same cruel words used in our experiment.
How does that make you feel? Why do you think they do that?
I don't know.
I apologize to you for them, and I think that's disgraceful. And you're a wonderful person and human being.
And despite all the abuse, Josh, our actor, is proud of his role.
All right, so think of that as a microcosm of society. So if you're involved in any movement, you have to deal with four kinds of people. Doesn't matter what kind of movement, gay rights, women's rights, animal rights, fracking, climate change, war, peace, four different kinds of people. The first group of people are people who are unaware. So people who are unaware. They don't know what the issue is. You say to them, fracking. They say, what's fracking mean? You're talking about drones. They say, what does that mean? Right? Most people didn't know what climate change was until the Al Gore movie came out. Right? People never heard of it. Now, who are these people in that scenario, people who are unaware? Think about how big that grocery store is. There's people in the back who can't see what's going on. They're not aware. So for these people, you have to raise awareness. You have to work. So as activists, right, and you do an action, how do you raise awareness? The second group of people are people who are not persuaded. So these are people who have heard of drone strikes and they say, well, those are good. They keep us safe. Right? Climate change, I've heard of that, but it's not man-made. I've heard of gay marriage, but I'm against gay marriage. So you have to persuade those people. Now, who are those people in that scenario? They're the people who can see it, but maybe they agree with the abuser. Maybe they're like, yeah, I wish I could go home early. This is taking too long. So they're the person who actually supports the abuser. The third group of people are people who are not motivated. So they're aware, they're persuaded, but they don't have the motivation to do anything. So they say, yeah, I've heard of war, but I'm against war, but what can I do? It's never going to change. Nothing's going to get any better. This is why cynicism is so dangerous. Cynicism is extremely dangerous to movement. I'm just one person. I can't make a difference. Nothing's going to get any better. It's all pointless, right? So they're persuaded war is wrong, but hey, what's the point of doing anything? So these people we have to motivate. And the fourth group is people who are not empowered. So these people are aware, they're persuaded, they're motivated, but they're not empowered. Who are those people in that scenario? You see some of the people, they have very uncomfortable looks in their faces. And you can tell that they're bothered by it, but they don't know what to do. Maybe they're the big man, and if you're a man and there's a big man bullying somebody, you might have to fight this person. He might want to fight you in the parking lot, right? So maybe they're motivated, but they're not empowered. Now, if you're dealing in a movement, any movement, you have to think about these four kinds of people. And if you do a tactic, what are you trying to do? Are you trying to raise awareness? Are you trying to persuade people? Are you trying to motivate people, empower people? Are you trying to do three of those, all of those? So this makes your actions much more strategic, much more focused. Right? What are you trying to accomplish? How do you interact with those groups of people to reach critical mass?
Let me show another video. I like this video a lot. It's about interracial marriage. And keep in mind, it was illegal for black people to eat at restaurants in the South. And the civil rights movement did not even want to touch the issue of interracial marriage, right? 1958, only 4% of Americans approved of interracial marriage. They didn't even want to touch that issue. And interracial marriage was illegal in a lot of states until 1967, late 60s. And so this shows how much that issue has changed. This video is filmed in Texas. And you just see how different things are. So if anybody says, well, things don't change, right? They wouldn't even let a black person in a restaurant in the South 60 years ago. And now look at how people react to this kind of abuse. And again, you have people who are in the middle, people who don't do anything. And look at how, remember when the people threatened violence, a lot of you in the room cheered. Right? I think some of the pacifists in the room might have cheered. Right? But the thing is, nonviolence is more powerful than violence. You don't only have two options. Nonviolence is the most powerful method. So how do we empower people with nonviolence? Okay, so this man's abused. These are actors, the abuser and the people being abused.
We're just
not married?
Yeah. You're really married up, Davis. But less than a minute later, the conversation turns.
I just feel bad for these ladies over here. You got two attractive single girls over here, probably just waiting for a man like you to pick them up, and you got chocolate milkshake.
Okay. Also turning is this woman's attention.
If I was in your place, and a black girl took a white guy,
and she doesn't hold back.
These relationships, that's fine. We're all human beings. If you have a problem with that, then you need to be somewhere where it's not common to have that type of relationship. But I don't know where you're going to be at, because
this is weird. To be clear, Texas is not a place where interracial couples can be harassed.
Like I said, you're going to sit there right in the middle of the meal and leave us alone, or you're going to get up and walk out.
When it's clear that it just can't be stopped, in one last act of solidarity, Adriana Thompson stands up to leave.
I'm glad you guys don't deal with me.
But of course, we can't let this hero go without talking to her.
Oh.
You got in their faces.
Well, I mean, it's the truth. It's your color. This is who you are. You didn't choose this color. So why should I hate you because of something that you didn't choose? For something that is you.
If this all sounds familiar, it's because we've done it before. But in the Northeast, sometimes thought to be more liberal and tolerant of interracial relationships.
You should be dating a white woman, quite a black woman today.
But already, Southerners like Adriana are fighting back against those long-held beliefs. Will others be as willing? This man can't believe his ears as he sits in stunned silence.
It's a good thing you don't have kids. And be polluting our race.
Suddenly, he just can't stay quiet any longer.
Why don't you throw this man out? You don't belong here. He even pleads his case to the waitress, who's also what would you do after? He rests for what there is and call the cops. But not everyone is as quick to come to our couple's aid.
All I'm saying, this is Texas, this doesn't go on here. Just cut it out. Name up. Go to your black chicks and make out with the public. Go to your places. Intact, you know? Keep the race intact, right?
For more than 15 minutes, our instigator continues his bigoted loans.
I was worried about my property value, bro. And they have all the black girls, like, taking when you showed up at the lottery. You can take that stuff downtown, you can take the suburbs. Don't bring that trap here. All right.
Finally, this man gets up to leave in protest.
I'm sorry.
While this woman tells the waitress.
What happened?
Not shooting him.
But still, no one takes on our actor directly.
You did all part of the TV show. It wasn't real. Good.
No, I'm a little bit upset. That's ridiculous. People shouldn't treat people like that. Maybe I didn't get up and act quick enough, like I should have. But I just wanted to make sure I was here for what I was here. I'm glad I spoke up. I wish I spoke up sooner. It's one thing I regret.
And what about those patrons who sat nearby?
The establishment's problem, not mine. So as far as comforting the black and white temple, you felt
I couldn't care less.
Why didn't you confront the guy? Comfort the couple?
Because I was with my husband and he was around. And I was submissive one.
In legal life, our actors, Marcus and Lisa Laurie, are married, and they're the proud parents to these two adorable little boys, who they worry might someday face discrimination. Back in the diner, we're at it again, not quite knowing what to expect. Ironically, it's about to become our most powerful scene of the day.
I thought this must be like some social experiment or something.
Whatever.
And then my buddy wanted me to say to you, doves need to stay with doves and blackbirds need to stay with blackbirds. You know, right?
Ridiculous.
Ridiculous. Our actor Cameron tries to rope in some surrounding support.
I apologize, because normally we don't do the vanilla chocolate thing here, you know.
But it doesn't seem like anyone agrees.
Well, I'm sure it's like a racist comment to this couple over here.
Oh, hell no. Take it somewhere else. Take it somewhere else, guys. You don't need to be making out any day. Hey, no.
But when Cameron ratchets it up one last time, all hell breaks loose.
I was going to say one thing, and we'll leave you guys alone. If you guys are married, I hope you don't have any kids, because that's just going to be polluting our race and all that stuff.
These strangers band together like brothers to fight our racist ranter, and before things get out of